Okay, this is Andre Novosiltsev. He'll say his name probably for you too. So he's been active in the Sage community for a while, and he's been using it. I keep getting emails from him about, I'd like to do this interact. Can I do this? So I look forward to hearing about his experiences.
Thank you. So I want to talk today about mostly use of interacts in multivariate calculus and worksheets in linear optimization. As I was listening to other talks, I remember that I've done, as one of my first users of Sage, teaching this GIF animation, actually, for differential equations. And here we have a rod with hot part, cold part, and ends at a constant zero temperature, with modes for the heat equation combined into the dashed curve. And I think it looks very pretty, so I was very satisfied when I managed to do it back in the beginning of 2011. Okay, so what I actually want to talk about is how I have used interacts for multivariate calculus, why I have used, maybe try to make it a little bigger, and why I have used my own service, both for Cell Server and for Sage Notebook. And I hope that my reasons are not reasons just for me. On the one hand, we should probably try to solve these issues in the public internet service, so that they're not present anymore. On the other hand, some of them just cannot be eliminated, and that's a reason to keep supporting notebooks that you can install locally. So what I was doing with interacts, I did not embed them into any kind of web pages that had some other stuff on them. It was it was a web page, but just for an interact. In 2012, it was quite difficult to do. One of the problems then were, for example, that the timeout was very fast. When the interact times out, then you do not get any feedback. And both of these issues were fixed, so thanks to Jason, and I guess William maybe too, and Ira, and many other people. I have here several interacts, for example, the surface plotter, which got 288 click directly through Moodle by my students. So if they had it in the history, if they shared this link with someone else in other sections, as some of them have done, I will not see it, with 74 students, I believe, in class, 288 clicks show that definitely they are using it. This was one of the simplest interacts, because literally it's just plotting several surfaces given by implicit equations. I just made it so that you don't need to know the syntax of Sage for this. And I will not show you what it does, you can imagine it. What I want to show is the most popular one, straight rated integrals. And accidentally, on the second talk of today's morning, you have already seen the beginning of the interact code. So let's try to go there. And you see that it does not work. So what I have done, I have eliminated everything that Jason was talking about yesterday. You do not need to click on the button to make interact code work. It should be auto-evaluated on my own server, which is not currently running. And you can embed arbitrary HTML into your interacts. And the question is whether you should put some explanations there, because if you cannot see the interact, maybe you should not see the explanations, or maybe you should not, because it's extra load on the server. And I thought about it. I decided that actually both ways have the use. So what I have done now, the HTML, which describes something that you can do with this interactor is inside of the interact. So if the interactor is not working, you do not see them. But this is just a plain HTML that tells you what you can do if something does not work. You can try a different browser, you can try mailing me, and you can also try a public CLI version. So let's go there, where I forgot to put notes into the top part, but here auto evaluation is turned off. You do need to click on the button, and when everything works, you see something like this. So what you see is just the cube, and it's a region of integration for this iterated integral from 1 to 3 in each of three variables. And you can imagine that if we are using this interactor to set up some integral, and I figured out, explained to students how to set up the first integral, for example, and entered the information. Then I waved my hands a bit more, and we figured out how to set up the second integral, and then the third. And then in the end, we press update and nothing happens. That's really annoying. So that's where that issue came into that the timeout should be long. And if it did time out, it's nice to get some feedback so that you cannot anymore enter anything into the input boxes. Right now, if it will time out, not always, but in most cases, everything grays out and input boxes become inaccessible. And I'm personally quite proud of this interact because it works in different systems of coordinates. So, for example, here we can see the same cube, but in spherical coordinates. And of course, you can put whatever you want in the limits. So maybe we can put
WebGL version. Running as soon as possible, so those of us with wacky Java.
That's really cool.
Here you have something. And another thing that will be very important for this project is that you should be able to specify layout. And it took me a while to figure out how to make these integrals look like integrals with upper and lower limits. What I would also like to do is to specify the tabboard, I guess it's called, so that I can put my cursor into the lower box, enter something, hit tab, and enter the upper limit. Then go down and tab, so that if I already have an integral written in front of me, then I can sort of enter it in the way how we read mathematics. Yeah, so I suppose it's easier
a solution for that, I think.
To do, but it would be quite convenient.
They just use a form or whatever. Make sure you put the controls in the right order.
And another feature is that you can try to compute it. And it's called try to compute, not compute, because sometimes you cannot do it. Because if your limits here depend on some parameters, then whatever we use for symbolic integration, I suppose it's maxima, cannot compute definite integrals if it does not know whether they are real or not, and so on. So in those cases, I try to use, I believe, does computing antiderivative, no matter if there are some problems in the middle. And if it does not work, maybe I try something numerical. So I try to get answers no matter what. Sometimes it makes me into a liar because I gave an example to students and said, well, you see, the problem with this integral is that in this order we cannot compute it. I entered it into Sage and yes, we can compute it. Of course, we may need to use some special functions in the middle, but they can see what can be done and what cannot. There is a little bug on this page that this DP actually should be here. And that's because of enabling automatic line breaks, which I think should be disabled. Because here it still is fine. It may appear that it is better than if you have a single line which you need to scroll back and forth. But I've seen much worse examples, which I will demonstrate to you shortly.
Quick question. How long do you want for a timeout? Right now, I just looked and it's 10 minutes, not an hour like I was thinking. How long is good for a timeout?
I think an hour would be better.
An hour? So this is the timeout between one interaction to the next interaction?
Yes.
1 hour?
Yep.
And you say 75 minutes. We have 70 minute classes. Okay, so I'll make it 75.
We have 80
minutes
classes.
Okay.
I taught classes 100 minutes long, though.
Well, there is some measure of server resources here, but okay.
Well, I mean, I don't know. I think that probably the most important limit is computational time, and 30 seconds, I think, is fair.
Yeah.
And then if you have something which is
hanging
active
around,
but is not in use, it can be a bump to swap, so
right.
Okay, it's not a big problem.
It's not
And let me now switch to another interactor. The same
you have one for surface and line integrals?
Say it again?
You have one for surface and line integrals?
Oh yeah, that's what I'm going to show you. Vector field plot, which was not so popular, it seems, but maybe that's because students figured out they can reuse it from the browser history, or just not close the page top. So again, we need to go to a public version. And here we are. So it's a Möbius strip with some vector field with the boundary which is given as a parametric curve. And I heard some comments that you need to try to make these interacts simple. In this case, it seems to be quite convoluted. There is a lot of controls. There are more on the bottom that you don't see right now. And I actually would like to make it even more complicated so that you can duplicate several of these boxes and the curves which are given piecewise. Because in many problems you have several curves or several surfaces, and I think that it does not really make it much more difficult to use, but it makes it much more flexible.
So with some of the changes we make, you could have a little plus button up there, and when you press the plus, it would create a new thing there, and you could enter a new function, and another plus button, and you could create a new function down there.
That would be wonderful.
Yeah, stuff like that. So these are the things that are enabled by the Williams changes.
And it can be like for a group of controls, because for each function I want to enter components, I want to enter the limit for the parameter.
Yeah.
Wonderful. So on the bottom here we can also try to compute it. And I believe that will demonstrate the problem that I was talking about. Yes. So there is a scroll bar, but we can see that something is definitely cut off, and there is no way to access it. So for these purposes, it also would be very, very good if we can have some kind of tester for interacts that can check not everything, of course. If you have a box where you can enter arbitrary expression, you cannot do it. But at least some predefined set of values, maybe 10 of them, definitely trying to click each of the checkbox, not necessarily no combinations, maybe all at once. And if we, so say I can plot this vector field only along the surface S, I believe, and it works. Which is not yet in Sage, but I hope to put a patch sometime in the near future. Note also that this surface integral, the flux of the vector field through the Möbius strip, is not mathematically defined, of course. But you can compute it, so I was using this interact to demonstrate to students what exactly is happening. Because I cannot do these computations by hand, especially if they're actually meaningless. But I could have shown them that I can reparameterize the strip a little bit so that the gluing point is shifted, and then the vector field is the same, the surface is the same, the value of the integral is different. So that's exactly what I'm trying to explain, that this integral has no meaning. There is no value that you can meaningfully associate it. Anyway, so to compute flex integrals, you are interested in normals as well. And I have implemented plotting normals, and it did work, but now it throws some errors. And I can probably fix that error in a few minutes if I get into the code, but not every potential user would be able to do it, and in any case, you should be able to get notifications that something is broken. So
this is matplotlib deprecated something? And
maybe.
It's
also possible that I have... I have done here, I took the plotter for vector fields of UK7Sage, I tweaked some of the parameters, and then I modified also the code to allow plotting along curves and surfaces, and maybe I use something which is not necessarily breaking backward compatibility, unless you go deep inside,
right.
But still such things happen. So why I wanted to use my own cell server is that I don't want this to happen, and if I stick with a single version of Sage and cell server, then it will not happen during the course of the term. I wanted it to be available because, of course, I'm always ready to teach without any computers and maybe without power, at least if the room has windows. It can be really annoying, for example, if you want to talk about vector fields and their plots, or rather maybe slope fields for differential equations and Euler method, then it really does not work well without a computer when you have a demonstration plan. Those issues, I think, are addressed, at least for those who have a good internet connection. Public cell servers work very reliably. And the fact that I was using my own server also allowed me to collect some statistics on the usage. So the interesting part is over here. And it's memory usage by the virtual machine that was running the server. The machine only had 2 GB of RAM. And I had 74 students in the class using Moodle. I estimate that 1/3 of them were using it actively. It may be higher, especially with students from other sections. So apparently 2 GB is perfectly fine to support 20 to 30 students. And the spikes here is committed memory. It's okay if it goes a little bit up, and if we use WOP a little bit, I didn't notice any performance regressions. I also could see that the spikes do coincide with due time of homework and with usefulness of interacts that I have created for doing homework. So I believe that the highest spike corresponds to homework on iterated integrals in 3 dimensions, when I think it's absolutely awesome thing, and some other students think it as well, to just check that what you have done is correct. Because you got some limits, you put them in, you see that the plot is totally off. Or maybe it's not totally off, but it computes area under rather than over something. So it's easy to fix mistakes. And the homework for this course was actually done mostly through WebAssign, which claims to have some tools as well, I think. I'm not really aware of them. Probably students are not aware of them as well, because they still use them to write this. I collected some feedback on the first students saying that they never tried to use Sage because there is a beautiful thing called Wolfram Alpha. I don't know, I tried to go there to plot some vector fields and surfaces, and some things I was not able to do. Some things it seems that I would be able to do if I get paid subscription. So I don't think that Wolfram Alpha is a replacement for it in any way. And I want also to show some feedback from the statistics from students. So So 23 students answered it out of 74, so it's somewhat self-selected, of course. So the question was which issues of Sage applets have to be addressed most, and it was a multiple choice question with possibility of multiple answers, but it's not that five students have just clicked everything. I was looking how it was growing in time, and first some issues went ahead, then others caught up. My thinking was that they will all want better support for mobile devices, because I got some complaints about it. But apparently they're also concerned with loading time, with response time for updates when the interact is running, with reliability. Also, I don't know what were complaints here, because I was trying to make them inform me if anything goes wrong. I did not get any reports, and for me it was very reliably in class, at least when I started using them actively. And six students indicated that they want offline access, which also somewhat surprised me, but if they want offline access even to these applets, then probably for notebooks, for worksheets, rather they also want offline access, so supporting installation is quite important. And which device would you prefer to use Sage applets most? Windows PC is leading by far. That was also a bit of a surprise for me. I thought it would be an iPad or some other kind of a tablet. But apparently that's where they want to use it. It's also possible, however, that these were the students who actually used the applets, and they used them because they worked, and they worked because they were on a Windows PC. Oh. I don't know.
Yeah, your applets, it looked like, pretty much don't work on the iPhone and iPad because they use the Java stuff, right?
Yeah. Yes.
Right.
There was also extra unpleasant thing, which we actually saw in the previous talk, that when you have a 3D plot, then browsers force you to click that, yes, I agree to run Java application, and it appears every time when you do the update. And now it seems that it got fixed in recent Firefox versions, so recent Java versions, I don't know. So that, of course, is not something that Sage can really do anything with, but maybe if we migrate to non-Java renderers.
Higher
parity
list.
Were the students sophomores or freshmen or juniors?
Sophomores, mostly, I think. So it's a 200-level course, intermediate calculus too. Mostly, I think, it was calculus for non-engineers. So it doesn't include like chemists, physicists, but also linguists, historians. You only have separation for engineers. Okay, then let me now switch to series 73 course, which is mathematical optimization and linear programming. What I have done for this class, I first taught it in 2011 in the fall, and I was terrified that I will do some mistakes in simplex method in the solutions for final exams, and it will look to me that the problem is fine, but it's actually terribly hard computationally. I also did not want to mess with all the nice formatting for problems, so I wrote a module which helped me to address these issues. I showed it to some students, they were not particularly interested. Then I taught this course again in the fall of 2012, and by that time the module was in much better shape. And I had some extra labs where I showed students how to use it. So many more compared to the first time we're using it, maybe 20, 30, depending on particular chapter out of 50 or so. This is actually my last run in the spring term, which I was expeditiously grading right before departing for this workshop, where I have set up a dedicated notebook server, and at least from the Moodle there were 2,044 clicks on it to access it. This time there were 61 students. What I have done this time to address some of the homework submission and cheating issues, which I'll comment maybe a bit more later, each of the students was supposed to come up with their own problem and then solve this problem using the techniques that we were learning. And I was giving them some general guidelines on what features do I want their problems to have, what should be the size, not much else. The conditions were that they have to submit their work for preview by other students then after receiving comments submit a final version. This submission has to be typeset. So it doesn't have to be in CH, but it cannot be handwritten and scanned. It has to be typeset. Given that these are linear inequalities, I don't think that it's such a big pain to do it in Word or any other, including just plain text editor. Nobody chose that option. They all went with CH, and I had feedback in the end asking them, did you really realize that it was an option not to use CH? So they said that yes, they realized it, but they chose to use it. So why did I run separate notebooks here? In 2012, I really wanted to use Sage 5.4.beta 1, and I installed it as my server before it was released officially as beta, because it had MassJax rendering. Here is one of the worksheets where we have beautifully typeset a linear programming problem with some corresponding dictionary later, which is scalable. So in class I can increase it so that everyone, including the back row, can read it and the quality does not degrade. In the very first run I had to prohibit Sage, try to render it using JS Mass, and everything was done as PNG by later on the server side. When I was running it in the spring, I used 5.9, but I made the module that I have written as a patch. So if you try to create this LP problem in standard form currently in Sage, it will not work because the patch is not merged. The solution for it to avoid the patch is to attach the module. But it's extra steps, if students want to create a new worksheet, then they need to remember to put some command, which I don't necessarily explain them what exactly does it do and what is the syntax. So they had issues with that. Using it as a patch avoids it. And as we were going on, there were some reports about issues which were bugs in my module, and I could fix them very quickly. And since I was running my own server, I could also apply that patch very quickly. So I got a report about the error. 1 hour later, it's all up and running with a fixed problem. I don't know how well that will be addressed in the Sage Cloud currently. Because you can install your own server, your own version of Sage in a project, and you can patch it, of course, but I don't want to share a project with students so that they all can see each other's workshops. They still have to be separate users. Then for each of those users, I want to run my own patched version of Sage.
The only way it'll work is if I make it easy to for them to copy a patched version of Sage into their own projects. But that's completely reasonable to do. But given the distributed and scalable nature, like some people's projects can be hundreds of miles away, on different servers. So it'll just have to be that they'll say, "I'd like to use this version of Sage that's maybe in this project," and request it or something.
You'll just get.
And
I don't know.
Has to be some kind of permanent link that will keep it in sync.
So you just get pull and then get update.
Something like that.
You could use Git to manage the Sage source code.
Yeah, it'll be kind of like that. I don't know. I mean, I think you'll have a pre-built version in a directory, and then that will get maybe rsynced to another project. They might be able to allow you to rsync things into their project, but not have the other access in the other direction or something like that.
Let's have this conversation at 2 then, just to make sure we get through the...
It can very much be solved in the framework of this, but it's not solved yet.
Of course, when I have 60 students working on that mandatory homework assignment, and once I enter it, it's probably hard to switch back to typing it and something else. I cannot risk that a public notebook will go down, and in particular, 60 students is kind of too much of a load for it.
Yep.
So for that, I also had to run it locally. In terms of resources for this usage, it seemed to me that everything is quite fine. So on the top, we have logged in users, and I set it up with a separate account for workers, for the workshop processes, so you can track how many workshops are open just by looking at the number of active users. And you can also see the spikes for first submission and final submission each week. Here's memory usage, which for the purposes of the class, I think, stayed under 8 gigabytes. So 8 gigabytes was enough to run it for 60 students. The fact that it goes up into Slopware is because of me messing around with other stage computation. And I probably should wrap up, but let me go back to the worksheet and show a little bit what was actually done here. So in addition to all this nice rendering, here's what I really wanted, is that in the simplex method, you have a dictionary, you pick a variable which has plus in front of it, it's entering, you compute ratios of several numbers, you pick a variable which is leaving. That certainly can be done by hand quite accurately. If you cannot do it accurately, you should practice your arithmetics. But then the next step is to take this equation, resolve it for this variable, and substitute the result into all other equations, which is also easy, but it's so much computation that it takes a lot of time, and when you do 2 plus 3 100 times, and one time it will happen to be either 4 or minus 5. And that's what I wanted to avoid by writing this module. In addition, here is a discussion of what we can do when the problem is changed after we have solved it. We modify the dictionary, we solve it in a single step. But I can also demonstrate now to students right away what would happen if we applied the regular process of solving it. So I get something much longer, which I certainly would not do by hand if I had to. But since it's free, I can at least just count how many steps were involved. And one of the problems with these solutions, which I'm still not entirely sure how to solve, is that it shows up nice if you wait long enough to render everything, but it's difficult to insert into PDF of solutions for exams, and it's difficult to just print as a HTML printout. Because it's a single block, and so it tends to be broken off.
Yep.
So I'm not sure what would be the optimal solution, but presumably that's not the only place where we can get a long output, which would be nice to break into several pages somehow automatically.
So this seems, do they get the matrix Tableau approach to this, or
do
they always stay with the variables in the course?
So for this course, we start with this regular dictionary approach. We start with graphical solutions, which you can also do. Then we also switch to revised dictionaries somewhere here. In principle, we also have a Tableau approach for transportation problems, which I have not programmed into Sage yet.
Okay.
but certainly that can be done.
So there's not a lot of linear algebra matrix.
Not much. Well, when you fill in these tables for a revised dictionary, you need to do some multiplications and so on.
Ask if there's any other questions for Andre.
And so just to finish, what our plans on campus after getting a 3-year grant is to push Sage into other undergraduate courses and for use by other instructors, not necessarily those who know Sage very well, or particularly keen even on using technology. And for undergraduate courses, we have enrollment of about 5,000 students a year, so that would be a big crowd. And again, the question is how to support notebooks which will handle this amount. And then, of course, if William's cloud version will handle 1 million users, then several universities with 5,000 students in each is not a problem. Otherwise, it is a bit of an issue. We also plan to run some graduate or senior level course that will reduce TAs capable of helping students with their Sage issues and also helping other instructors to produce material for Sage. And one of the problems there is how do you provide all these materials to other instructors. So for example, here it's not just module which I hope to include by Apache into Sage, it's also a collection of worksheets which show how to use this module, and I don't think that belongs in Sage in any way, so it has to be in somewhere separate place. For interacts, I also think that the multiple list selector that we have seen in the morning is very convenient. I actually was not able to find it easily a few months ago when I tried to. I could find the new interactor website, but not those lists anymore. And those, I think, work much quicker if you know what you're looking for, although it's difficult to submit something there. And my ideal view is to have the list as it is now, where you have arrangement by topics, but then also perhaps add second arrangement for the same interacts, where you can select your university, select the course number, and then see the interacts arranged, say, by the time frame of the course. So, some things to think about. Thank you.
Great. We invite you to ask Andre some questions. We're going to break for lunch right after announcements, and then reconvene at 1 o'clock for a short interact tutorial and discussion, 2 o'clock for Classroom in the Cloud. William, do you want to lead that?
At 2 o'clock? In the cloud.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
Classroom in the Cloud.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes. Okay, here at 2 o'clock.
Classroom in your cloud.
Yeah, in your cloud. No, no. And then 3 o'clock, Rob is leading a discussion on the
Sage
book series. That's right. But Rob, first, you have some announcements.
No, those were them. Status reports at 4:40.
4:40, yep.
And that.
And then 10-minute survey.
And then surveys.
Yep.
So that's the afternoon. Migrate next door and work all afternoon, or take part in sessions over here as you're interested.
Or find another room if you find a group of people you want to get together.
Or go to lunch on the
app. Yep. Great.
Free time. Early release.